Good afternoon. Welcome to the History Film Forum. My name is Chris Wilson, and I'm the Director of Experience Design here at the National Museum of American History. We're so happy to see you all here today and to really begin our screenings on the last day of our second annual History Film Forum, which is a collaboration between the Smithsonian and the National Endowment for the Humanities, and we're presenting this four-day exploration of history on the screen. Some of you who I see some in the crowd who have been with us, well, first of all, how many people have been with us since Thursday? Great number. That was really great to see and hear back from you. Last year, we got a lot of feedback that though we developed the program as kind of an a la carte film festival and people kind of drop in and drop out for whatever films they were most interested in, we got a lot of feedback that people would like it scheduled much more like a conference, because we had many people like those who raised their hands who wanted to go to just about everything. And I know at least one of our attendees has been to every single session. So I want to give him a round of applause. Those of you who've been here for a number of sessions have heard me say that Rick Burns and his film, his films, and our relationship with him, and American Experience, and NEH is really the reason that the History Film Forum exists. When we were looking for our initial content in 2015, Karen Middleman, who I'm about to introduce next, gave me a call and said, "Would we be interested in screening Rick Burns's film, The Pilgrims, last year?" And I said, "Yes, we'd certainly like to do that. And what if we made it part of this History Film Forum we're trying to put together?" And then eventually Karen and her team in public programs at NEH said, "Well, what if we partner on this whole thing and present these 2 years of programming?" So I'm so glad that we have that relationship with Rick and with Karen. And now I'd like to introduce Karen Middleman, who is the director of the Division of Public Programs at the National Endowment for the Humanities.
Thank you, Chris, and thank you so much to all of you. Especially thank you to Rick. Some of you know, if you were here last year, that Rick was our keynote speaker, and we're really honored to have him here again. So I'm not going to give you his entire filmography, because it would take the entire session that we have, but I think you all know that Rick is an internationally recognized filmmaker and writer. He's best known for his 8-part series on PBS New York, a documentary. Since founding Steeplechase Films in 1989, he's directed a score of films that NEH has been involved with. Some of the most recent ones include the Emmy-nominated documentary Into the Deep, America Wailing in the World, Death in the Civil War, a truly beautiful film that Drew Gilpin Faust mentioned in the New York Times. I hope some of you saw that last week. And The Pilgrims, which we screened last year. So we've been talking for the last few days about the relationship between history documentaries and collective memory, and the special power that films have to shape the way that we think and talk about the past. Rick does that beautifully in all of his films, but I think especially with the Chinese Exclusion Act, where he is excavating a moment in 1882 when this nation, for the first time, passed a law specifically excluding one racial group from citizenship and from immigrating to this country. Now, I just have to say, NEH funded this film at least 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago, when the world was a very different place. And I won't say more than that, except that I'm stunned by how relevant this film is today, and more with each passing day, to all of the discussions that we're having now about citizenship and immigration, but really about nationhood and national identity. So the film, I think, that you're about to see has a special power and a special resonance right now because of those issues, because they're top of mind. But the film is also just a testament to Rick's gift as a filmmaker, and his ability to take this one moment in 1882 and excavate it and probe its depths and look at all of its layers, economic, social, political, moral, emotional, and then give us back that moment more fully revealed, more fully recognized than we knew before. So, Rick, I'm grateful to you for being here, and you are all in for a great treat. I'm going to turn it over to Rick, who's going to tell us a little bit about what you're about to see. Thanks.
Thank you, Karen, so much for that introduction. And to you, Chris, and the History Film Forum and the Smithsonian and the NEH for having made this possible for a couple years in a row. Li Xin Yu, who's been my sort of unindicted co-conspirator in making films for 24 years now, which is a testament to something, I don't know what, is who's here tonight. She co-directed the film with me and edited it all herself. So on behalf of Li Xin and me, and also our partners, we've been blessed by having partners on the West Coast at the Center for Asian American Media, particularly Stephen Gong, who runs it with his partner, Donald Young, and they're the executive producers of the film. So on behalf of Cam and Li Xin and myself, we want to thank, we feel honored to be back here with the film this second year. Felt like we had kind of found our way home when we walked in the door last year, and so we feel like we're coming back home again this year. You know, the funders of the film, some of whom are here today, including individuals who gave support very, very early on. Li Xin's brother, Zhuan Yu, and his wife, Margaret Cao, I really want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. That made all the difference early on. Patrick and Marguerite Sung, also here, thank you. You know, to our major, major funders, to CPB and PBS, and then to the National Endowment for the Humanities, I simply can't begin to thank you for it. I mean, there's, when I think about what the what public memory in America would be without the National Endowment over the last 50 plus years, I'm not sure we would have a memory, whether it has to do with exhibits and museums and sort of archiving manuscripts and teaching, sort of teaching training workshops and creating curricular materials, all that stuff which is kind of completely invisible, but kind of like infiltrated, insinuated into the sort of body politic of the American learning public. And that's before you get to, you know, the hundreds and hundreds of hours of film that they have supported, and usually supported with key juried grants early on, which gave an imprimatur, which were sort of severely juried. And so when you came out the other side of it and you got the money, people went, "This, there must be something to this." And so that money always leveraged at a rate of like 4, 5, 6 to 1. So it's not just that the NEH has supported, you know, sort of 32 hours of the films that I've had the good fortune to work on, not including the Civil War series, which they also funded, but that the funds that they make actually are the open the door to creating the possibility for the project full stop. So when I think about it that way, I just go, it is this an agency that shows what public-private partnerships are about. It's the, sort of like the mouse that roared amongst federal agencies, and it's impossible to imagine our sort of our country without it. The project. Li Xin and I finished this film so recently that it's really not finished. We finished it yesterday. So that means that we'll no doubt be going back to make tinkerings on it. But as a, as an editorial matter, it really is done. But it's so freshly that you know, you'll sort of see the steam rising off it as it goes on. In some ways, literally, this is the first time it's ever been seen. The film is, you know, and I think in a certain way, I'd like to think of it as not so much the first screening of a finished film, but the last screening or fine cut of a work that's not still in progress so much, but in a cutting room that happens to hold 300 people. So we'll be very open to any comments and thoughts you might have about how it can be changed, but we will not in any way follow your advice. There are no end credits to it. I'm gonna race through a list of thanks. They can't let a film go out in public without thanking many of the key people. I also want to let you know what you're not going to see. The runtime of the film right now is 2 hours and 40 minutes, which feels short to me. What you're going to see today, and I know I'm sure the disappointment is going to sort of ripple through the crowd, is only going to be 95 minutes or so. And that means you're going to be seeing the film from the beginning, the first two-thirds of the film. And it's going to stop abruptly with no warning. at a particular moment and leave you at a cliffhanger, so you have to rush back and see the gripping conclusion to the Chinese Exclusion Act. There's another piece of, that we excised from it just to kind of bring it down in time and not make it too unwieldy, and that's a scene early on after the introduction about the China trade. I mean, Chinese people did not show up in America in a vacuum. You know, China and America had had a long prehistory, long before the gold rush. And so that scene we took out simply because we had to lose a little bit more time. We would be nowhere without the men and women you're going to see on camera, and including some who you won't see on camera because the film didn't include their remarks, not because they weren't incredible, but because the film didn't quite go that way. So I want to thank Jack Chen, extraordinary historian, our chief consultant, Mei Nye, Martin Gold, who is here today, is going to tell you more about the American politics of the Chinese Exclusion Act than anybody else in the world. An extraordinary scholar, Ren Chou Yu, Erica Lee, a scholar, Mary Lou, Gene Feltzer, Kevin Starr, sort of the historian laureate of the state of California, who alas passed away just a few weeks ago. David Lay, Scott Wong, Li Ching Wong, Phil Choi, Ted Gong, and Michael Lin, who aren't in the film but have given us so much support, including fantastic sort of reflections on camera. Our composer, Brian Keene, who I've worked with since 1989, is here. Brian, a shout out to you, and Jeff Fres Albrecht, thank you so much. My colleagues, Catherine Clenard, are here, Greg Soren. The narrator is Hoon Lee. I guarantee you, he's an incredible actor. You might know him from Banshee, extraordinary Korean-American, born in Plymouth, Massachusetts. He has never before narrated this kind of film. I know he's going to be heard continuously on American public TV after this film. He's the best narrator I've ever heard, but also the voiceover of Russell Wong, Yet Fung Ho, an old and dear friend of Li Shin's, Joel De La Fuentes, and Fenton Lee. Last of all, Li Shin and John. Li Shin Yu, my partner in making films for a long time, John Reese, her husband, who I think thought when he got married to her recently that she wasn't going to be put into the witness protection program, but in fact that's sort of what it's been like. So I really want to say that I thank you both from the bottom of my heart, and to Karen Middleman, Mark Ruppel, and Chairman Adams for the NEH. Thank you again from the bottom of my heart. Hope you like the film, and look forward to talking with you afterwards.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for our History Film Forum and for staying for this wonderful film that we just got to see. My name is Xavier Carnegie, and I'm the host of Seriously Amazing Objects on the Smithsonian Channel, as well as the My American Roots web series on the National Museum of American History's YouTube channel. We are just about to bring up our panelists for our discussion on this incredibly emotional and provocative film, but before we do, a couple of things I want to let everybody know. We're going to try to get through this as quickly as we can because we are running low on time, but I'd like to have a couple of questions and answers. We apologize if we have to cut it off and limit it, because we will have to do that. But when that time comes, I'll let you know when. You can make your way to the microphones to the left and the right in the middle of the aisle, and we'll try to get through as many people as we can. Also, if anybody has a cell phone, can you please silence it or turn it off? We want to make sure that we're respecting everyone and that everyone can hear what our illustrious panel has to say. At this time, I'm going to invite our panelists to come on up. And as we go through these questions, I will introduce them. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. First, I would like to introduce our filmmakers. Rick Burns is an internationally known multi-award-winning filmmaker who has directed and produced many films on history and was the keynote speaker for last year's History Film Forum. Li Shin Yu is also a filmmaker and is a prestigious editor on award-winning programs, including working with Rick for 23 years, and is co-director of the film we just saw, The Chinese Exclusion Act. Can we please thank them for sharing their film with us? You know, Rick, Li Shin, I always like to begin these with an idea of kind of the inspiration. So if you don't mind sharing a little bit with us, what is it that got you to want to tell this story, particularly through film?
we first came, I mean, this is such an unknown and forgotten history. It's part of our history that's just not in the general American knowledge, you know. And we came across it when we were 20-some years ago working on a film on the way west, and came across the story of the Snake River Massacre. It was just such a horrifying event, and how do we not know it? And we work in history, and so that started a decades-long sort of thinking about potentially making a film about this. And I think, you know, the then, New York historical.
The sort of proximate cause was.
You're okay.
Just good. Louise Muir, who's the president of the New York Historical Society, came to Leisha and me about 4 years ago and said that she wanted to do an exhibit at the New York Historical Society on Chinese exclusion, which was a really groundbreaking idea. And in fact, the New York Historical Society, Louise and her colleagues, Leisha and I, came down and made the case in the National Endowment for this double project on the exhibit, as an exhibit and a film. The exhibit opened called Chinese Exclusion / Inclusion in the fall of 2014, and I thought it was a really wonderful exhibit and has now taken up permanent home at the Chinese Historical Society in San Francisco. But we, you know, we sort of set to work. It took us longer to get it done than they. But the odd thing is that, sort of, as Karen Middleman pointed out initially, was sort of with each passing year as we worked on the film, the light it shed on American history, contemporary reality, and conversely, the way the contemporary reality shed light on the story was sort of startling, so we felt like deer caught in the headlight at the end of the day, that it was just sort of such an amazing moment of conversion, and very much, again, as Karen said in Leishan, about how we construct national memory. What are the things that we end up remembering, and what are the things that we end up forgetting? And how is it that, how did we come to think of ourselves as a nation of immigrants? Did we begin that way? Well, no. And the Chinese exclusion story runs like a very bright and sometimes very dark red thread through that whole question of how have we defined our relationship to peoples from the rest of the world.
Well, I'd like to come back to that in a few moments. Before that, though, I'd like to introduce Faith Davis Ruffins, who is a curator of the Division of Home and Community Life here at the National Museum of American History, and previously the head of the Collection of Advertising History. Faith, Lachine mentioned that we don't know these stories. Why don't we know these stories? Apart from the fact that, you know, it's hard to fit a lot into the umbrella of history, you know, in a course, but why haven't we seen more of this in films, not just documentaries, but even feature narratives? It seems like it's a gold mine for folks.
Well, I think one reason is that the notion of the American West has a lot of mythology associated with it, and we're very familiar with those stories, but while there are Chinese populations throughout the United States, this story really has a very important resonance in the West, because California, people in California lead the movement to exclude Chinese people, and the importance of Chinese labor in building the western part of the Transcontinental Railroad is so crucial. But which is also part of the railroad is part of our story. But as you see in the film shows you that when you see pictures of the Transcontinental Railroad, you don't see very many pictures of those Chinese laborers who were working on it, who in fact not just worked on it, but made it possible, yeah, in part because of their experience with dynamite and other kinds of explosives, which were absolutely necessary to get through the Rockies in order to build that railroad. So I think that the narrative of the West, which is very powerful and has other aspects that are hard to remember, just didn't include, it was easy to leave out this very complex story. And this film goes a long way to help the wider public. Now, I do want to reinforce the notion that, including our scholar who is sitting here with us, there are scholars, Erica Lee, May Nye, Jack Chen, and others who've been working on this history and publishing this history for the last 30 years. But the wider world is going to not so much read historical scholarship. This is the kind of film that can appeal to a much wider population of people and therefore make that story better known.
It speaks to the necessity of many of the films that we show here at the History Film Forum. I want to introduce Martin Gold. Martin is a partner at Covington and Burlington LLC, a longtime government and private counsel, and the author of Forbidden Citizens, Chinese Exclusion, and the U.S. Congress, A Legislative History. Martin, I was wondering if you could talk to us about House Resolution 683, Congress's regret for the Chinese Exclusion Act, and your role in getting H.R. 683 passed.
Thanks very much. Covington and Burling was pro bono counsel to the Chinese American community on a three-year project to get resolutions both through the House and another through the Senate to express the regret of Congress for the passage of the Chinese exclusion laws. I can tell you that when we began this effort, there was almost not a soul in the Congress that understood the history, any real part of the history that this marvelous documentary addresses. Judy Chu of California was the first Chinese American woman ever to serve in the United States Congress. She was the author of the House resolution, and we had a Republican co-sponsor for her. Scott Brown of Massachusetts was the Republican sponsor of the resolution in the Senate, and we had Dianne Feinstein as the Democratic co-sponsor for him. Even Judy Chu, coming from a Chinese American background, had only marginal knowledge of all of this, and none of the senators had any knowledge of this. So we really were playing very much on a blank slate. I believe the things that got this through, principally, was the fact that, emphasized often in this film, that the Chinese exclusion laws were not just about immigration. They also denied people legally in the country the opportunity to become American citizens. And no matter what people in Congress thought about immigration, pro-immigration, anti-immigration, more liberal, more restrictive, everybody found the idea that people could not aspire to citizenship to be abhorrent. And so for that reason, we were able to put the House resolution through in 2012 and the Senate resolution through in 2011.
Great, thank you so much. We're going to open it up for questions. Again, we have time for a limited number. Those of you who do have your questions kind of thought out, if you would make your way to the microphones to the right and to the left. Before we do open that up, I have one more thing to ask our panel, and this is kind of for all of you to think about. Obviously, there's a parallels and social commentary in this film to stuff that's going on today. Not exactly the same, of course, but I was wondering, is that, for the filmmakers, is that intentional when you think of this? Is just this just an example of human nature rearing its head? And for everyone, what do you think this film has to tell those of us who are seeing these issues being discussed and wrestled with today?
I mean, I think as Lee Shin pointed out, we didn't really begin it in anything like the time frame that we're currently living in. And we've been asked many times, you know, were we seeking to address these issues? And I think, you know, like so many moments in history, the more you sort of penetrate them and dig down, the more you discover the truth, you know, as William Faulkner said, and people quote him to the point of tedium, if not nausea, you know, that history is not was, history is. Meaning that, you know, as you look at the artifacts and the documents, and as Lee Shin pointed out very early on, there are two heroes in our film. Those incredible people like May Nye and Jack Chen and Ren Cho Yu and others who've kind of done the primary historical work. And then the documents themselves. When you can see those documents, you can see the lynchings, when you can see the act, somehow it's corroborated and substantiated in a way that makes it real, and at least for us, the filmmakers, riveting. And I think that what we wanted to do was really make a film that addressed sort of fundamental American questions. you know, anybody born after the Second World War acquired naturally the idea that we'd always been a nation of immigrants. And we had acquired the idea that, for example, what made you an American citizen was the fact that you were born here. That's like the air you breathe and the water you drink. But the fact that that anyone who's in this audience who was born here knows that he or she was an American citizen is a direct legacy of Wong Kim Ark, 1898, who was an American-born son of Chinese immigrants who had gone back and forth a couple times, and on one occasion in the 1890s was excluded and denied entry. And he took it to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said, no, 14th Amendment citizenship clause, it applies to persons. If you were a person born here, you are due all the rights of American citizenship. So it turns out the process of American history is much more complex, much more like a Mobius strip winding back and forth between past and present. And I have to say, never more so than in this subject matter has it sort of revealed to me, and I think to Leisha as well, how active, slippery, and changing memory is.
I would like to say that it's very important historically in this moment to remember that while the United States has been has received many peoples from around the world, at the same time, there has always been anti-immigrant feeling in the United States. And the 1882 law that is the Chinese Exclusion Act is the first act to really deny people as a result of their what is called their race or their culture entry. But it serves as a model for other exclusion acts that are passed later in the 20th century. So most Americans today do not know that in 1924, a National Origins Act was passed explicitly to reduce almost to nothing immigration from Southern and Eastern Europe, to exclude all people from Asia, to exclude all people from the Arabic countries, and to severely reduce the possibility of anyone immigrating from Africa. That law, with some additional laws that are passed after that, holds true until 1965. So the notion that the United States is a nation of immigrants is one that is very powerful today, but it was not always so, not even throughout the 20th century. There are many people who argue that that was not really true, and that there were other sources of origin, and that the United States was a country that was supposed to be built by people from Northern Europe, and that was it. That is not the history of the United States. Many, many other peoples have been involved in the building of the country, but the notion that we are a nation of immigrants is a newer concept. For a historian, 50 years, 60 years is relatively new. It's a newer concept than some older ideas. And those older ideas are still part of our population, and they resurface periodically. We may be in such a moment today.
I want to address the newness of this concept. My grandfather landed in New York City on a boat from Russia at the end of 1907. It was the peak month of immigration into the United States, history of the country. At the time he arrived, he was 20 years old, spoke no English, had no particular skills, but he was welcomed into the United States because he was a European. He became an American citizen as quickly as he could, and he had a 50-year love affair with this country. Had he been Chinese at that exact period in time, he would have been precisely the kind of person who would have been excluded because of the Chinese exclusion laws. Just a few years before that, Congress passed the last major extension of the exclusion laws in 1902. At that time, there was a major debate between Democrats and Republicans about how exclusive the legislation ought to be, but absolutely nobody, except for one person, decided that there shouldn't be exclusion altogether. At the end of a week-long debate in the Senate, a senator from Massachusetts stood up. His name was George Frisbee Hower. He had been a senator from 1877 until his death in 1904, so during this entire exclusion era, and had always opposed Chinese exclusion legislation. He didn't say a thing for that week of debate, In the last moment before final passage, he stood up and said, "My problem is not with the details of the bill. My problem is that this legislation violates fundamental American principles rooted in the Declaration of Independence. Therefore, I'm going to oppose the bill, and I'm bound to record my protest if I stand alone." The vote was 76-1. So at a time when American immigration policy was wide open to Europeans, the very sort of racist attitudes that allowed you to distinguish between Europeans and Chinese, brought out in this wonderful film, had so permeated the Congress that they saw no problem deciding to extend indefinitely the Chinese exclusion laws. That is the 20th century, friends, not earlier.
And it's important to note that had your grandfather tried to come in 1925, mm-hmm. he might have been excluded.
He might have been excluded.
Right, and as you say, Faith, that as the rest of our film goes on to right. touch on our detail, all of the subsequent laws, both extending the Chinese exclusion, then the creating the Asiatic Barred Zone in 1917, then gets picked up in 1921 and 1924. So this isn't just, Martin points out, a story about 0.2% of the American population. This is something that is resonating, so to speak, throughout the American body politic and becomes scaffolded and scaled for what's really a kind of another 50 years of more broad exclusion.
All right, folks, we want to do a quick Q&A. If you could please keep your questions brief. I know there's so much to cover, but we really want to make sure we're getting through everyone. So out of respect for all the other folks who are going to have questions in our audience here today, please keep your questions brief. We'll start right over here to the right.
Thank you. My name is Chen Tu. I came to United States about 22 years ago, so I'm an immigrant. And thank you for making this film possible for me too, and my daughter, seventh grade, she's sitting right there, to see. And I actually read a couple of books about the history of Chinese in America, and I was obviously horrified about this after I coming here. And my question is, it happened in 1882. What is the historical context that the general American people or through their legislators to pass this law specifically against Chinese American? Was there because Chinese American were direct competition with European American labor? That was a main course, or because they are so different from their behavior, their outfit is so different from the rest of the American people. What was the direct reason? And also, I know that other races might be more severely against, like African American, all these. What is the context that they create this law to specifically target Chinese American? Thank you.
Well, I think that's a very the answer to your question is very complicated. But I would briefly say it's important to understand that by 1882, after the Civil War and after the end of Reconstruction, the United States already has, many white Americans feel that the United States already has a really problematic racial situation because they have a large number of African Americans who they see as unable, many people see them as unable to become full Americans. And so there is a tremendous desire among many people to not add to the population that will be racially different. And some of the reasons not to add, some of the examples that you gave, such as labor competition, which was claimed but is not necessarily evident historically, also the notion that this is a non-Christian population, that it is this is a time of what is called social Darwinism, where people believe that there was a hierarchy of the races, and white people were at the top, and other people were in the middle, and African Americans and Africans were at the bottom. So the idea that we're going to add more people who are not Christian, who are not white, who are not European to our population when we already have this problem that has caused a civil war, creates the context in which these reasons gather greater and greater power to a wide number of American citizens who are voting, and the people in Congress are reflecting what they see as the will of the people.
There was also a point brought out in this film that I think bears emphasis, and that point is that you were at a situation in American history where the political balance was very much at issue. In other words, after the South was reconstructed into the Union after the Civil War, elections in this country were exceptionally close in the Electoral College. Five elections in this period of time were decided by razor-thin margins. Twice, the winner of the Electoral College was not the winner of the popular vote, and it almost happened a third time. So to compete for votes on California, Oregon, and Nevada, politicians on the East Coast, the Middle West, and so forth paid serious attention because it was believed that the balance in presidential elections might be held on the Pacific Coast. Republicans and Democrats on the Pacific Coast both stood forthrightly for exclusion. But around the rest of the country, there were some differences. But you could not deal with this issue locally. It's brought out in the film. There was also a Supreme Court case that said this is a national issue, federal authority, not local authority. It's up to Congress to deal with it if Congress will. And Congress will once they believe that the outcome of national elections could depend on the outcome of electoral votes in a region of the country where there was this agitation.
We have time for one more, and we'll go over here to the left.
I'm Jim Lowen. I'm a sociologist. I wrote the book Lies. My teacher told me my first book, my doctoral dissertation a long time ago, was The Mississippi Chinese Between Black and White, which deals with the people left from that Memphis convention that did end up in the Mississippi Delta, and some of them are still there. My question, though, it's actually an editing suggestion that you said you didn't want. And it has to do with the fact that the expulsion of the Chinese from more than 50 towns in California and from every county in Wyoming except one and from the whole state of Idaho just about and so on was kind of a dress rehearsal for what I call the Great Retreat, which is the creation of sundown towns all across the West, and for that matter, all across the Midwest and the entire North, against African Americans. You can imagine that once a town in Utah or California drives out its Chinese folks, it's not going to be very hospitable to the next African American folks who come by. And after 1890, then, all kinds of towns across the West drive out their black populations, some of them even to this day, but mostly it's a matter of up until maybe 20 years ago. And so I'm hoping that maybe you can insert at least just a sentence, because that generalizes the story. What happens to one minority can happen to another one, even a much larger one.
That's an excellent point. I agree with it. I think that we'll follow your advice, though I said we wouldn't.
All right, folks. Okay, the first thing I want to do, we're completely out of time. Can you please join me in thanking our panelists, our filmmakers, for sharing their expertise and this film? Yes. All right. Now, what we're going to do is we're pushing the next film, or the next discussion, which is Hollywood Shuffle on African-American representation in film, particularly narrative film. Well, I guess narrative and documentary. We're pushing that to 4:15. So what I'm going to ask everyone to do is please clear the theater, and if you are registered for that, when you go into the queue, you can see the folks on the desk, and they'll make sure that everybody gets in timely, all right? All right, so please, you know, post haste as carefully as you can. Make your way out, and we'll see you guys who are registered at 4:15.